World Trigger is a series I got into roughly a year and a half ago, and it was a series that I honestly really enjoyed from beginning to end. And with season 3 currently airing, most likely in the midway point right now at the time we're recording this video, it honestly surprises me why nobody talks about this series. Not just the anime, but also the manga now that it's monthly. So I just wanted to give my personal thoughts on why I like World Trigger and why some people should give it a shot. And this is primarily with the anime that I'm going to be talking about, as I'm going to jump into the manga right when season 3 ends up finishing, and then I'll probably end up doing a proper why you should read or why you should watch slash read type video that I've done with other manga that I've caught up with in the past, in the future, but for now, this is going to be like a good like midway point. For those of you who don't know, I actually made a World Trigger Season 2 video back when season 2 first aired, and I said how it was a pretty great return for the series after being gone for so many years due to the manga being on indefinite hiatus due to the author's poor health. And once the author returned with this series being monthly before, when it was weekly beforehand, the anime ended up getting a proper return at the beginning of this year, and now it's in its third season in the same year. But after looking at how many chapters there are, this season will most likely be the last season for a good while, as while the series is a monthly manga release, it will take some time for the next season to come out. And if they maintain a good like 11 to 13 episode format as they've done for seasons 2 and season 3 right now, then this series could still keep going without feeling too dragged out. But anyway, let me get into the real meat of this video: why you should watch or read World Trigger. But again, this is primarily for the anime at this moment, as the manga is still ongoing and I haven't caught up to it as of yet. World Trigger began as a manga series back in 2013 of February in Weekly Shonen Jump, and it was a weekly serialization, and it eventually ended its weekly serialization in November of 2018, after 5 years, due to the author's poor health. As he continued to draw and write the series, he began having severe neck problems, so the series was put on indefinite hiatus. But he then later returned later in that year as a monthly series, as it was transferred over to Jump Square, which is where it's currently being run as of this point in time. The anime ended up beginning roughly in 2014, a year into the series development, and I'm gonna be honest, it does kind of show, because the beginning couple of episodes of World Trigger, well, is a nice introduction to the world and the power system, kind of takes its time leading us into what the series is going to be overall about. World Trigger is a series about a group of characters that are in this organization called Border that are tasked with protecting the world from invasions from other dimensions by enemies that are dubbed neighbors. And they begin to invade the specifically Mikado City, which is the main focus of the series, as this is where these portals tend to open up. And the neighbors, primarily with these Trion soldiers is what they're called, they invade, destroy the cities, and kidnap people for power, which is something that we inevitably learn. And to combat them, the agency Border was created, and they use this power system, these devices called triggers, powered by Trion energy, which all humans have, and they all have a different level of Trion within them. Which is honestly an interesting story beat, because as far as I can tell, there is no real way for someone to gain more Trion energy by simply training. Mainly have to train your own skills and use of particular different triggers, as the triggers are used very differently. There are sword-based triggers, there are gun triggers, there are even shield triggers. There is a vast majority of triggers, but it's all set in their own little categories, and characters basically specialize in their own fighting techniques based on those triggers, while having backup triggers, whether it be a gun trigger or something as like a backup, depending on the situations. But many characters primarily focus on one particular trigger as their specialty. And the true appeal of World Trigger's fights with these triggers is the fact that the environments and teamwork are used well-choreographed fight scenes in which strategy plays a very crucial role in these fights, as you need to utilize both your Trion levels and choreograph with teammates and even other agents in the field to take on enemies that you wouldn't normally be able to take down in regular combat. Which leads into the variety of triggers, with the addition of the Black Trigger, which is basically, aside from the usual triggers that are in fact created with particular typings, Black Triggers can basically do almost anything, from opening up small wormholes and portals, to being able to copy other people's specific abilities, to even just laying traps beforehand that you can activate remotely. There is a wide variety of black triggers, but they are very rare. And I don't want to get into spoilers on how black triggers are created, as it's a very interesting concept in and of itself. But black triggers are honestly something in the series that whenever someone has a black trigger, you really have to think on your toes for how to beat someone with a black trigger, as they could basically take on a whole platoon, a whole army if need be, of lesser or weaker soldiers, as it is implied and even shown to us in specific flashbacks, that a small group of black trigger users can wipe out an entire resistance if that particular resistance is not skilled enough or resourceful enough to manage to pull off taking on enemies of these particular power groups. And that's one of the reasons why World Trigger is just so enjoyable to watch, not just for the fight scenes, but how these fights basically feel like a chess match, essentially. You have these set of characters that are in a situation where they have to fight soldiers that are very powerful and tough to take down regularly, and you have to find creative ways to break down their armors and manage to take them down from a very basically out of the box way without brute forcing it. And then you have the introduction of either other trigger users from these neighbor worlds that are very skilled combatants and are from different kingdoms, and we know that there are multiple different kingdoms or worlds in a sense in the World Trigger universe. But the black trigger users add a whole nother level of complexity to these fight scenes, that making these characters have to by tooth and nail just to take them out. Now, the power system of the triggers is honestly really good, aside from the whole strategy aspect. The one thing people would complain about is the fact that there might be a low level of stakes. The reason this being is because when border agents activate their triggers, their real bodies are replaced with Trion bodies. Basically, their own body is stored somewhere else in like a little pocket dimension in a sense. I can't explain it too well, but instead it's replaced with a Trion body that is the exact same as their own, just enhanced physical strength and speed. The pull off some of these feats, and let's say they end up losing limbs or get fatal wounds, they don't lose blood and they don't die. They lose their Trion energy, and thus once they're out of enough Trion to essentially maintain that form, the triggers automatically use this thing called a bailout function, which brings these characters back to essentially their home base in Border, where their real bodies will end up showing up and they will be safe and unharmed, if not a little exhausted from their recent battles. But there are moments where characters, after depleting their Trion, will still be in the field doing stuff like supporting other people or trying to find a way to fight despite not having a trigger to use, which does add some layers of stakes, as well as the fact that there are civilians that do not use triggers and can very well easily die and be brutally injured. Not in the fact that it's very possible that characters can die, as within season 3, this is a spoiler, so mark right here, skip ahead. It is stated that when Border first began, the characters that made Border, over half of them ended up dying in this big event that basically brought Border to the level that it is right now as a way to unify people and helped Border become the prominent force in protecting people from the neighbors. But yeah, the stakes in World Trigger are essentially non-existent for people that use Trigger, but it's not gone, because characters can still very well die once they're brought out of their Trion bodies. They could even like disarm their Trion bodies willingly if they want to, and that second, once they're out of their Trion bodies, could be when they get hit with a fatal attack. Now, I know I kind of went on about the power system, the strategies, and how this series kind of works in terms of its fight scenes and its power system, but that's because I wanted to give you guys a good picture of how this series ends up showing itself, and one of the reasons why it's enjoyable. Another reason why it's so enjoyable is because of the wide variety of characters, and World Trigger has a lot of characters. Now, on the surface level, you could think that a couple of these characters look pretty generic, not too very memorable designs, but after getting through the first couple of episodes, couple of chapters, you'll begin to recognize these different characters, and you'll begin to like them very, very much. Primarily within Tamakoma branch, since that will be the branch of border agents that you will be primarily seeing, as that's where the main cast consists of the main group, side characters and supporting characters from the other branches of border, as you grow to like and appreciate them as well. I feel like the creator, the mangaka, has a really nice way of writing characters just bounce off each other with really fun personalities and interactions. I just find hilarious and also just heartwarming at times too, as one of the favorite characters, Yuma Kuga, who you would think is the main character, and I certainly think he is the main character, but the main protagonist seems to be the other character, Osamu, who is basically a relatively normal person. I just want to talk about Yuma in particular, because he is kind of cocky, he's arrogant, but also very, like, underestimating his opponents. He'll talk down to people, make jokes and snarky quips. He's just an overall joy to watch, and he's just one of my favorite characters in the series, just because of not just how badass he is, but how he tends to just bounce off of any character he's with in any given scene. He's like one of the most enjoyable characters in this series, and I honestly love it. Now, just one quick thing before I get into the rest of this video, before I cap it off, is something that I neglected to mention when I was mentioning the power system. What I like about World Trigger is that the triggers are the main power system, but there are some characters that have this thing called a side effect. I do not remember how this came to be, but most likely it was like triggered from like dimensional breaches. Awakening these latent superhuman abilities, which isn't like a full-on power-up, but it's more like a psychic ability. For instance, Yuma has the ability to detect lies. He can tell when somebody is lying, but not specifically like what they're saying is a lie when it's surrounded by truths, which is something very interesting, as it's not a very battle-hardened ability, but it's good for interrogating prisoners in a sense. Another character, Jin, who is honestly one of the best characters in the series, and like I talked about, Yuma, who bounces off of every character. Jin is basically just well liked by everybody in Border, save for a couple of people. He's just the most liked character in this entire series, and he's just a great mentor figure for the characters. But one of the things that I like about Jin is he seemingly has control over every possible situation that he's in, with some levels of him trying to figure out the right way to deal with these situations, as his particular side effect is being able to see the future, which is actually very handy because it helps them prepare for a multitude of scenarios, and he can even see like possible like choices that can be made to lead to a better outcome. While not ultimately super clear, the farther he can look, you can only see probably a couple of minutes in the future, maybe a few days. And there were moments where he's like, when you're like, wait, did he just plan all this out from the very beginning to go in his favor? And it's just very enjoyable to see him like basically play 3D chess with other characters in the series, and he's not even a malicious character. He's easygoing and kind of lazy, and kind of likes to prop people up so that they could basically be the best versions of themselves. And honestly, Jin is honestly one of the best characters in the show. And Tamakoma in general is just a wide variety of nice personalities that you can really get attached to. Same with every character in Border, honestly. And it's just one of the reasons why I like this series so much. The wide array of characters that bounce off each other, the power system, the strategy in these fights. And the world building is honestly pretty great because, like I said at the beginning of this video, the world building is one of the things that was eased into you when you first started watching the show. As, like I said, it shows that the series was made a year after the series' source material had been going on, and it shows with the fact that how slow it originally started out until it kind of picked up speed a little bit. We don't talk about that filler arc towards the end of the first season, but yeah, that's, no one wants to talk about that. When you watch the anime, if you just go through like the first like 10 episodes, like just fully absorbing what we get, then you will be very well. Honestly, you'll just enjoy the series overall as you keep going to watch. This series continues to build up upon itself, not just with the world building and the power systems and characters, but just the overall feel of the series is honestly just great, just really fun to watch. And I can't wait to jump onto the manga, as I believe that if season 3 ends, there's a strong possibility there's enough material maybe for one more season at the moment. But once I finish catching up to the source material, I might do a proper why you should read video. And if that reaches us, if that ends up doing very well, and if this video does well, maybe I will cover the series monthly as the chapters come out. If that's something you guys want to do, because I do want to get more people interested in World Trigger, as it's a very, very good series that deserves way more attention than it gets. So yeah, World Trigger is a very fun series, great power systems, a nice layer of strategy involved in the battles and the team formats. As the series goes on, it goes more in depth as to like basically team formations, the setups of teams, trigger lineups, etc. And it's just something really fun to watch and to see that this creator really does go in depth with how he wants these fights and the story to be structured, with these different characters with different personalities interacting in these very strange and honestly kind of stressful situations at times, which I honestly have to say is a really nice change of pace from the usual shonen battle series that we get. So yeah, World Trigger, very good series. I highly recommend it. Go give it a watch, and or just read it flat out, because you'll breeze through the opening chapters within a few hours if you really get into it. And the anime, the opening 10 to 12 episodes, like I said, are pretty slow, as it shows that it was basically been created a year into the manga's initial release, which A, shows how much faith the studio and the company Shueisha had in this series to be good. But the production kind of shows that this was made in a time where seasonal shows were just on the rise and other popular shonen series were ongoing weekly with that type of format. So, again, it shows in the early production stages, but the series gets much better as it progresses past those opening episodes. To cap off this video, I just want to say that the main reason why no one really talks about World Trigger is primarily because, A, it's a monthly series, and two, it went on a bit of a hiatus with the author's health problems, and so people weren't able to get into the series, and with the anime ending literally within like a year and a half to 2 year run, it makes complete and total sense why people just fell off from the series, as the end of the first season was like, we don't know when we're coming back or if we will ever come back. But stay tuned, and then we get this series coming out like roughly like 5 to 6 years later with the season 2 and now season 3 with the series going monthly, so it gives the author more time to do stuff. It'll give the series more time to flesh out, which is something that I'm okay with, and I honestly can't wait to see more. But yeah, if you really like this video, leave it a like and subscribe to the channel. It really does help. Very close to 1,000 subscribers, so I really hope we reach that end goal before the end of the year. And also, again, as I stated, if this video does well, then I will probably cover World Trigger sometime in the future. I might do a why you should watch / read video in the future on World Trigger once I catch up to the source material. But until then, I hope you guys enjoyed the video and hope you all have an awesome day.